Hi, Bridge. A division of Recorded Books presents The Summer Nanny by Holly Chamberlin, read by Rachel Dulude. Character cannot be developed in ease and quiet. Only through experiences of trial and suffering can the soul be strengthened, vision cleared, ambition inspired, and success achieved. Helen Keller. Chapter 1. Beautiful spring weather came late to southern Maine, and now, when it had finally made its appearance in mid-April, Lita Latimer was taking full advantage by opening all the windows in her studio to let in fresh air for the first time since the windows had been shut tight the previous October. Just the week before, the vibrant yellow forsythia bushes had mellowed into lush green. The first and then the second robin had been sighted, and the ubiquitous muck of mud season had begun to dry out, leaving ruts in the driveway and along the path around the side of the house. Ruts Lita could handle. Wallowing in wet ground, she could not. Lita was a lifelong resident of Yorktide. She wore her dark hair in a ponytail or in a casual updo. At 40, she didn't yet need reading glasses, though she suspected she would need them before long. Doing the sort of work she did put a strain on the eyes, for Lita was a craftswoman, as her mother had been before her. In fact, Lita had learned all of the basic skills she knew from her mother, and while making a living by crafting was a bit laborious, Lita could imagine no other way of spending her time. She would have liked her daughter to express an interest in craft work too, but Amy had less than no interest. Many years before, Lita had tried to teach Amy how to sew a button on a blouse. Blood had been spilled. Lita's blood. Lita was proficient at a variety of skills from rug hooking to embroidery, from beading to sewing. She made particular clothing items for Amy and made alterations to her own clothes, both of which cut down considerably the cost of maintaining their wardrobes. As for work that paid the bills, there were two main categories, what Lita called the custom and the commercial. The custom work itself could be divided into two categories. Work produced from Lita's original designs and that skillfully copied from famous works of art. When a customer wanted a particular item and couldn't find it in a brick and mortar or an online store, she came to Lita's studio and browsed through her ready-made designs or worked along with Lita to get the vision in her head onto paper. This process could be anything from exhilarating to frustrating, but in the end, the results were almost always gratifying for both Lita and her client. The second part of Lita's custom work was the reproduction of popular works of fiber art, from designs produced by William Morris in the 19th century to works dating much farther back in history. For example, people were mad for the famous unicorn tapestries. The originals, created between 1495 and 1505, were masterpieces of needle and thread, color and design, and Lita never tired of the challenge of recreating the beautiful and poignant scenes depicted in the seven works. She and her clients were particularly interested in images pulled from The Unicorn Is Found, The Unicorn in Captivity, and The Lady and the Unicorn Tapestries. Because of the time, effort, and artistry that went into each of these meticulous recreations, Lita was able to charge a healthy price for each of them. On occasion, interesting commission work led to more commercial enterprises. For a local woman who was proud to trace her ancestors to Scotland, Lita had occupied several of the surviving bits of embroidery stitched by Mary, Queen of Scots, during her long incarceration in England. Once word had gotten around that Lita could produce such small masterpieces without the aid of a kit, orders came flooding in. The most popular of the images were without a doubt the ones that featured animals. The Kate, Jupiter, one of Mary's pet dogs, Delphin, a dolphin, Frog, and Eep were clear favorites. Lita's bread and butter work, however, was making originally designed rugs, pillows, chair pads, table linens, and accessories like eyeglass cases and change purses. These she sold locally at home decorating shops such as Wainscoting and Window Seats, owned by her friend Phil Morse. Lita also sold her work at the Busy Bee Quilt Shop and a few of the tourist stores in the area. She did have a website, latimercreations.com, though it didn't get significant traffic. Lita wasn't exactly good at self-promotion. In fact, she had set up the website only at her daughter's urging.
"Everyone has an online presence these days, Mom," Amy had argued. "You'll be totally left behind if you don't have a website."
Left behind what? Lita had been tempted to ask, but she knew what her daughter meant. Only weeks earlier, she had learned the meaning of FOMO. Vera, her closest friend, had explained it in context of an article she was reading about current trends in the food industry. "It means fear of missing out. It pertains to those people who need to be tuned into media of all sorts 24/7. Lita had laughed. "I live to miss out," she exclaimed, to which reply Vera had given her a look Lita found disconcerting. Maybe keeping one's head in the sand wasn't always the smartest thing. Still, Lita did all right. It didn't hurt that her mortgage was small, as her parents, Anne and Paul Gleason, had paid off most of it before they died. When Amy was 7, the little house on Hawthorne Lane came to Lita in their will. The house suited Lita's and Amy's needs perfectly. There were 3 bedrooms and a full bathroom on the 2nd floor. Amy had the largest of the bedrooms, Lita the 2nd largest, and the smallest was kept as a guest room. The 1st floor compromised a cozy kitchen, big enough for a table at which to eat meals, a living room, and Lita's studio. 3 of the studio's walls were mostly windows, allowing for plenty of light. An ear-piercing scream of the feline sort caused Lita to jump. The noise had come from Winston Churchill, though it might equally have come from Harry, a.k.a. Henry VIII. Both were large and grumpy and demanded constant attention. They were suspicious of visitors, even ones they knew, which was probably why Winston had let out a warning. Indeed, a moment later, Lita heard the back door, the one that led from the small hall off the studio into the yard, open and shut with a bang. Vera Cecil had a way with doors. A moment later, Lita's assumption was confirmed when Vera appeared in the doorway of the studio. Her short, dark hair was sticking up like a rooster's coxcomb, and she was wearing an old plaid shirt Lita knew for a fact she often wore to bed.
"Well," Vera announced, throwing her hands in the air. "It's over. Another relationship bites the dust."
"What happened?" Lita asked, putting down her embroidery hoop. "I thought things were going really well for you two."
"So did I," Vera admitted.
She strode into the room and flopped into the armchair on which one of Lita's hand-stitched quilts was draped. She was no sooner seated than Harry was on her lap.
"You'll read about it in the paper tomorrow, but I might as well tell you now. The charming Kitty Doyle is a bank robber. Well, she was a bank robber, back when she was known as Katie Dunn."
"Wait," Lita said. "What?"
"You heard me. The police turned up at the door first thing this morning with an arrest warrant. You can imagine my surprise. I hadn't even had my first cup of coffee. It wasn't until after 10 o'clock, 3 hours after the cops dragged my girlfriend off to the slammer, that it sunk in. I'd been harboring a criminal without knowing it."
"A bank robber? Really?" Lita shook her head. "Where do you find these people? Wait, don't tell me. I don't want to know. I hope the police believe you, that you had no knowledge of Kitty's past." Vera rubbed her eyes with the palms of her hands.
"They seemed to," she said. "But my lawyer will press the point."
"It's kind of too bad, really," Lita said thoughtfully. "I liked Kitty."
"True, she had that slightly freaky way of watching people out of the corner of her eye, but now that habit is explained."
Vera sighed and gave Harry a stroke.
"She made a mean beef stroganoff. I'm going to miss that beef stroganoff."
"You'll meet someone else," Lita said soothingly. "You always do."
"Nope," Vera said. "After this latest debacle, I'm resigning myself to being an old maid. I have spectacularly bad taste in women, and I can't see that changing no matter how many self-help books I read."
"You've been reading self-help books?" Lita asked.
"For years," Vera admitted. "It's been my dirty little secret, but I'm dumping them all now. Fat lot of good they did me."
"Maybe you should let a friend set you up," Lita suggested. "That way, at least you'll know the person is halfway sane. Well, assuming you trust the friend."
"Nope, I'm done."
Vera suddenly got up from the armchair, sending Harry flying.
He landed on his feet. I don't know why I'm so bad at meeting normal people. I had a perfectly fine childhood. My parents loved me. They even spoiled me. And maybe that somehow made my judgment go bad, assuming my judgment was ever good. It's a mystery for the ages. A mystery I wish I could solve for you. If wishes were horses. Well, I'm off. Just wanted to give you the big news. Vera came to a sudden stop and turned around. It just dawned on me. What am I going to do with Kitty's stuff? Even if she gets out on bail, she ain't living with me.
Send it to her family? Lita suggested.
That would be a great idea if I knew anything about her family, and I don't. What a mess. And with those words, Vera was gone, letting the back door slam behind her. Some people have really rotten luck in love, Lita thought, turning back to her work. If only a little bit of the luck Vera enjoyed in the financial sector could be inserted in the sector of romance, Vera might be a whole lot happier. For many years, Vera had worked in various administrative office positions until about 18 years ago, when she had inherited a fairly large amount of money from an aunt that allowed her to quit her job and move to Yorktide, where she set up her dream restaurant. Over Easy, a high-end breakfast place, closed in mid-October, after the last of the leaf peepers had gone home, and reopened in late May to catch what business the very earliest vacationers might bring. During the dreaded Maine winters, Vera traveled, visiting her parents in Arizona and indulging in spa retreats in Santa Fe. She often asked Lita to join her, all expenses paid, but Lita, while not stupidly proud, wasn't comfortable taking expensive gifts from anyone, not even her dearest friend. If ever she could afford to join her friend on a spa retreat, she would. Until then, she would be content with stories of hot stone massages and naked yoga classes. Well, the naked yoga stories she could do without. Too much flapping around. Vera had come to Yorktide not long after Lita's husband, Charlie, Amy's father, had passed. She had met Lita at the real estate office where Lita was working as a receptionist. The two women grew friendly, and over time, Vera had become sort of aunt and even a friend to Amy. Like Amy, Vera was interested in au courant fashion, something Lita wasn't particularly, so she made a better shopping buddy for Amy than her mother. Lita went to her work table and opened one of her sketchbooks. A vague idea had come to her the night before as she was on the verge of sleep. Now, pencil poised over the blank page, Lita tried to empty her mind of all extraneous noise, but it was not so simple. Vera's news of her latest romantic fiasco had brought to the fore of Lita's mind her own romantic situation, or lack thereof. She had been on her own since Charlie's death, not long after the birth of their child, Amy, now 21, and soon to graduate from college. In odd moments, but only in odd moments, Lita felt a pang of loneliness. Growing old might not be a lot of fun and games, but if you were in a couple, then at least you weren't alone when arthritis made it difficult to get into and out of the car, or gastrointestinal issues took much of the fun out of eating dinner out. Still, Lita knew that being on her own was a far better way to live her life than to spend it side by side with someone she didn't love or who didn't love her. She knew that without a shadow of a doubt. Shadows. Moody, crepuscular light. That idea had come to her the night before, just as she was about to fall asleep. Lita began to draw. Chapter 2. It was a beautiful spring day, with temperatures reaching the low 60s for the first time since who could remember when. Purple and yellow crocuses had bravely begun to poke their little heads above ground, and the rare daffodil had been spotted, a sure harbinger of better weather to come. Hayley Franklin, otherwise sensitive to beauty in all of its shapes and forms, was untouched by the scent of green wafting through the open window of her car. She was on her way to meet her boss, Judy Spear. Hayley had a bad feeling in the pit of her stomach. She knew that she had done nothing wrong. Still, when your employer summoned you to the office for a chat, things could not be good. Hayley stopped at a red light and immediately became aware that the guy behind the wheel in the car to her right was staring at her. She ignored him. She was used to the effect she had on men. The bolder sorts did more than stare. For the pigs, Hayley always had a few choice words that managed to shut them down. The unwanted attention drove her crazy. But what could she expect when she looked the way she did? Hayley was 5'10" tall and slim, with long legs, a small waist, and what she had once been told was an enviable bust. The ridiculousness of that assessment had almost caused her to smack the woman who had said it to her. A body part enviable? An intellect, sure. An excellent moral character, yes. But a body part? The light changed, and Hayley drove on, glad to be leaving the creep in the other car behind. For the past 4 years, Hayley had been working for Squeaky Clean, a small local company that specialized in cleaning private homes. Judy Spears had started the business when her husband had run off with another woman, leaving her to support 2 little children on her own. Haley's pay was good, but the work could be exhausting and sometimes a bit stomach-turning. A surprising number of otherwise civilized people didn't seem to mind hair accumulating in drains or spatter marks on toilets and floors. And on occasion, the people whose houses Hayley cleaned could be a bit high and mighty with her and the other women on her crew. Hayley resented this borderline callous treatment, but she always remained polite and took pride in doing her job thoroughly. After all, she had no choice but to keep quiet and carry on. She couldn't afford to be fired. Hayley still occasionally babysat in the evenings, though when her father was in one of his bad states, she stayed home. It wasn't safe for her mother to be alone with Eddie Franklin when the demons were upon him. Her longtime clients understood that she couldn't always be available and had never abandoned her for the simple fact that Hayley was great with children. And maybe also because they felt bad for Hayley and Nora Franklin. Hayley didn't like being pitied, but when it came to an extra $40 or $50 now and again, she could ignore the pity. You did what you had to do. And that was a lesson her mother had learned all too well. Nora Franklin was 47 years old. Photographs proved that she had once been attractive, but the joy in her smile was long gone. Her once shiny hair was now dull, and the lines around her mouth were deeper than they should be. For the past 9 years, Nora had worked as a bagger at Hannaford, the local grocery chain. The job was steady, and Nora was treated well. The only trouble arose when the family found themselves temporarily without a second car, due to Eddie's failure to make a loan payment or some other Eddie-instigated disaster. Then, if Hayley couldn't drive her mother to and from work, Nora had to rely on a fellow Hannaford employee. Haley's mouth set in a grim line as she drove past Forest Road. The Franklin family had lost their home on that quiet little street to foreclosure when Hayley was 10. She didn't know the details of how it had been taken. All she knew was that you couldn't dwell on what had once been, good or bad. You had to keep facing forward. You had to be ready for whatever was to come. Like more substandard living quarters. Since losing the house, Haley's family had been living in a series of apartments in buildings that were once grand single-family homes, but that had become generally run down and broken up into strangely configured living spaces. One apartment had only a stall shower and no tub. One apartment was so small, there was no room in the kitchen for a full-size fridge. Another apartment had an illegal second bedroom about the size of a large closet in which Hayley was forced to sleep. At least she had had some privacy. Her brother had slept on the old couch in the living room, his long legs draped over the couch's arm. Haley's relationship with Brandon, 6 years her senior, was pretty much non-existent. He had never been the least bit interested in being a big brother, and when he wasn't ignoring Hayley, he was torturing her in ways he thought were funny. Tripping her when she came into a room, taking her stuff without asking permission, once even cutting her hair when she was asleep. Their mother had tried in vain to control him. Their father had paid no attention whatsoever to his son, other than to take him along to the pubs when Brandon came of age, where too often they ended up getting into fights with other patrons, which most often resulted in their being tossed out into the street, markedly worse for wear. No, there was none of that hallmark domestic coziness in the Franklin residence, none of that sense of loyalty you were supposed to find in a family, the knowledge that no matter what happened, someone had your back. A long time ago, Hayley had decided that happy, devoted families were the rarity after all, in spite of those holiday commercials that depicted laughing grandparents bonding with doting grandchildren while moms and dads looked on fondly. Dads. The sad truth was that Hayley had only one memory of special time alone with her father, and she would never share it with anyone, not even her closest friend, Amy Latimer. It was too pathetic. Back when she was about 11, there was a popular show on network television called Prison Break. It probably wasn't an appropriate show for a kid her age, but no one had protested when she had joined her father in front of the old TV. Her father would sit on the couch, right in the middle, his legs spread wide. Hayley would sit on the floor. He never spoke to her during the commercial breaks, other than to tell her to get him another beer from the fridge. He never thanked her when she did. But he never told her to go away. A child would take what attention she could get and interpret it as affection. At least that was what Hayley had done, until one night Brandon came home about halfway through the show, boasting that he had scored $30. Eddie Franklin had turned to his son, eyes suddenly bright. Then he reached for the remote, turned off the TV, and taking his son's arm had led him to the door.
"Let's go to Mike's Tavern," he had said.
When her father and brother had left the apartment, Hayley continued to stare at the blank television screen. Deep down, she supposed she had known all along that the weekly hour in front of the TV hadn't meant anything to her father. Still, to have her intuition proved in so final a manner had hurt. Hayley pulled up outside the squeaky clean headquarters, located in a tiny strip mall, and went inside. Judy Spear was sitting behind the old card table that served as her desk.
"Hayley," she said, "thanks for coming in. I hope it wasn't inconvenient."
Hayley assured her that it wasn't. She was anxious for Judy to say what she had to say. The sooner you knew bad news, the sooner you could start to figure out how to handle it.
"I've decided to retire at the end of June," Judy announced, "and I'm closing down the business. My daughter is due in July, and without the father around, she's going to need all the help she can get."
Judy shook her head.
"It's far from an ideal situation, but I know it's my duty to do what I can for Charlotte and the baby."
Judy's reason for retiring was one you simply couldn't argue against, Hayley thought. Besides, the company was hers to do with what she wanted. Judy didn't owe her anything.
"I understand," she said.
"I've prepared a reference for you." Judy handed Hayley a typed sheet of paper.
"You'll see I've given you a glowing recommendation. You're the best employee I've ever had, by far."
After thanking Judy for her consideration, Hayley took her leave. Grimly, she got into her car. This was bad news. Similar jobs paid far less than what Hayley had been paid working for Judy. But she wasn't really surprised at this turn of events. Nothing good ever happened, no matter how hard she tried to make it happen. Hayley started the car and headed for home. If it could be called a home. Chapter 3.
"Where is it?"
Amy asked her room. Her room did not reply, though if it could, it might have said, "If you ever bothered to put things back where they belong, you might have found your headband by now." Clothes were strewn across the unmade bed, heaped on the rocking chair, and spilling out of the closet. The trash can overflowed with used tissues and makeup removal pads. An empty bottle of juice had been sitting on the windowsill for more than a week. A crumpled candy wrapper had been lying on the rug since Amy had dropped it there the night before. A slipper had gone missing over a month ago and had still not made an appearance.
"There it is,"
Amy cried, spotting the missing headband in a corner. Amy Latimer was 5'3" tall, neither overweight nor underweight. Her dark curly hair was unruly, but not problematically, which was good because hair products were seriously expensive. Her eyes were dark like her father's eyes had been. As for her personality, well, she was open and friendly and honest, and her mother was those things too, though Lita Latimer was a better judge of character than Amy had ever been. In that way, too, Amy was like her father, happy to think everyone she met was as nice as she was. Not that Amy remembered her father, having been a baby when he died. But her mother and grandparents had told her all about Charlie Latimer, and Amy had loved hearing the stories. Amy went to her small desk, the one her mother had used as a child, and opened her laptop. Checking her bank statement was a task she dreaded. There always seemed to be a nasty surprise. This time was no different. Amy frowned. How could she have so little in her savings account? Okay, she had sort of lost track of her goal of putting away $100 every week, or had it been every 2 weeks? But still, her expenses weren't huge. Her mother paid the mortgage and electric bill and whatever else needed to be paid to keep the house running. Sometimes Amy bought the groceries, but only sometimes. And her mother paid her tuition, too. Whatever money Amy made from a variety of part-time jobs was earmarked for day-to-day expenses, like coffee drinks and lunch at the college cafeteria and gas for her car, which her mother owned outright because it had once belonged to Amy's grandfather, who had paid off the loan before he died. And then Amy remembered. She had bought that new leather wallet earlier in the month, hadn't she? Not that she had really needed a new wallet, but it was the prettiest shade of purple. And she had also bought those cool sandals in two colors, black and light brown, because you needed some things in multiple colors. You just did. Darn, Amy muttered. She was supposed to be saving for her move to Boston come September. She would be sharing an apartment in Alston with three girls she knew from school and working at a cool new clothing shop called The Aces. Her mother had promised to help cover the cost of the move, but the last thing Amy wanted was to take advantage of her. Maybe she could find two jobs for the summer. The question was, what sort of jobs would pay the most? Maybe she would ask around at school. Someone might have a brilliant idea of how to earn a lot of money in just a few months. School. Amy had almost forgotten that there was an assignment due the next day. She reached for the spiral notebook on the floor by the desk and began the search for a pen. It was ironic. Here she was, an average student at best, about to graduate with a degree from a 4-year college, while Hayley, always an excellent student, hadn't even been allowed to complete a 2-year course at the community college. Life, Amy thought, could be so unfair. Though it hadn't really been unfair for her. In fact, life had been pretty darn good so far. Chapter 4.
A bank robber?
Amy said, handing her mother a can of peeled tomatoes.
As in someone walks into a bank holding a gun and wearing a ski mask?
I can't be sure about the ski mask, Lita admitted as she put the can into the cupboard and then reached into the second grocery bag. But I'm pretty sure a gun is required. Amy sighed.
Poor Vera. Why does this sort of thing always happen to her?
I don't know, Lita admitted. She's so savvy in every other way, but when it comes to romantic partners, her discrimination fails. That, or she falls in love with someone expert in fooling people into thinking she's normal.
Rats!
Amy exclaimed, holding up a box of cereal.
I got the wrong kind. I like the kind with raisins, not almonds.
Lita smiled. Did you take a moment to actually read the box before tossing it into the cart?
Probably not, Amy said.
Then her phone rang.
I have to get this, Mom.
Amy dashed from the kitchen, leaving her mother to continue the unpacking. And if Amy couldn't be relied upon to read the label on a package of cereal, Lita thought, how was she going to handle living on her own? Roommates didn't count. Reading bills carefully before paying them and remembering to turn the oven off before going to bed. Lita sighed. Amy was a rather naive young woman, still a virgin, impressionable, and prone to see only the positive and the obvious. And she was terrible with managing money. Rather, she was terrible about spending it before it could be managed. Lita continued to try explaining the basics of home economics and personal financial responsibility, but to no avail. As for a direction in life, Amy had never expressed an interest in a particular career path. In fact, it almost seemed as if she didn't much care what she was doing, as long as she was making money and having a good time doing it. There was nothing wrong with that attitude, even if some people might consider such a life as directionless. Lita experienced a pang of guilt. There was no doubt in her mind that she was partly responsible for her daughter's immaturity. She and her parents had coddled the poor, fatherless child Amy had once been, and it had been a difficult habit to break. But now, it was high time for Amy to grow up. So, while Lita was nervous about Amy's moving to Boston in the fall, she was also supportive of her daughter's decision. Amy needed to learn how to live an independent life. Amy returned to the kitchen as suddenly as she had gone.
"Sorry, Mom," she said. "That was Stacy. She wanted to remind me that Victoria's Secret is having a major blowout sale this weekend. We're going to drive to South Portland on Saturday."
"What do you need at Victoria's Secret?" Lita asked, hoping her tone didn't betray the trepidation she felt. None of the items in that store were necessary, and all were overpriced. At least they were overpriced for the Latimers. Amy shrugged.
"Nothing, really, but I'll find something to buy."
Lita gathered the empty bags and began to fold them neatly, one into the other. So much, she thought, for her lessons in home economics. Chapter 5. Hayley stopped at a crossroad, as a driver was supposed to do. Not that many drivers on these back roads obeyed such commands, like the man who cycled on past her on his makeshift three-wheeler. Raymond Windermere was the eccentric owner of a tumbling-down old farmhouse in the back of Beyond. Sticking out of the wicker basket strapped behind his seat was a haphazard pile of books. It was said that Raymond Windermere was insanely rich, but the only thing he seemed to spend money on in Yorktide was books. Hayley could understand such passion. She yearned for money with which to buy every book she had ever wanted to read and a copy of all the favorites she had already read. Thank God for the library. It had been her haven since she had first been able to read. In fact, Hayley remembered keenly the very moment her interest in history was born. Her mother had dropped her off at the public library in Yorktide while she kept an appointment with the doctor. As childminders, librarians were perfect for the parent with little or no money to spare. The 8-year-old Hayley had wandered from the tiny children's section into the not much larger section of adult books. On one of the blonde wood tables, there sat a thick book with an interesting title, Peter the Great, His Life and Legacy. Hayley took a seat at the table and opened the tome. Within minutes, she was captivated by the written contents as well as by the glossy images. If some of the vocabulary was new to her, and most of the names of people from foreign lands impossible to pronounce, the story was compelling enough to keep her turning pages. Suddenly, her intense concentration had been disturbed by the appearance of an adult at her side. The woman smiled and pointed to the open page.
"What's a little girl like you doing reading a big book like that?" she asked. "You should be reading one of those nice books written especially for children."
For a moment, Hayley hadn't known how to respond. Was she doing something wrong? And then it came to her very clearly that she wasn't doing anything wrong.
"Did you know?" Hayley asked the woman. "There was a person called Peter the Great who ruled Russia for 42 years. He was almost 7 foot tall."
The woman seemed disconcerted by Haley's reply and rapidly walked away. The incident was burned into Haley's brain. It was when she had first learned that there were activities that certain people were not supposed to engage in. People like children, girls, old people, poor people, African-American people, immigrant people. The list of who should not be doing X or Y just because they were who they were went on. It was when Hayley had first learned that the world was full of arbitrary rules and regulations, and while you might not be able to change all or even some of them, if you were smart, you could learn how to circumvent and even to ignore them. Since that afternoon at the library, Hayley had read every bit of European and American history she could get her hands on while keeping up with schoolwork, holding down sometimes 2 jobs at once, and being a good daughter to her mother, if not, in her father's opinion, to him. For Eddie Franklin's fatherly approval, Hayley would have to abandon everyone,
even her mother, and everything, even her reading, that didn't directly pertain to his creature comforts. And Hayley was not in the least bit interested in being her father's devoted personal servant any more than she was compelled to be by circumstances. Hayley steered her car around a significant hole in the road, all too common after a long Maine winter. This intense intellectual interest was the thing that most differentiated Hayley from her parents and brother, none of whom seemed to have any passions at all, certainly not intellectual passions. She often wondered where she came from. Who in her family had intelligence like hers? Was it someone on her father's or her mother's side? A great-grandmother or a great-great-great-grandfather? There had to have been someone in her lineage with a passion for learning. Or had she been switched at birth? Had the child really born to Nora and Eddie Franklin been handed over to civilized and cultured parents, while the child born to that civilized and cultured couple had been handed over to the Franklins? But no. One look at the shape of her hands, exactly like her mother's, and one look at the color of her hair, exactly like Brandon's, and one look at the color of her eyes, exactly like her father's, was enough to convince Hayley that for better or worse, and it was for worse, she was indeed of Mackenzie Franklin blood. Hayley turned onto Hawthorne Lane. The Latimers lived at number 22. No sooner had Hayley parked her car in the drive than Amy was beckoning to her from the porch.
"Come up to my room," she said. "I want to show you what I got at the Victoria's Secret sale."
Hayley followed Amy to her room on the second floor. One thing Hayley knew for sure. If the room were hers, she would keep it far neater than Amy was in the habit of keeping it. With a mew of distaste, Hayley picked up a bit of orange peel with her fingertips and dropped it into the already full trash can. Amy showed her two form-fitting t-shirts, one pale pink and the other white.
"Aren't they pretty?" she asked.
"They're nice," Hayley said mechanically. Could there be two more impractical colors?
"What's wrong?"
Amy asked, eyeing her suspiciously and tossing the t-shirts across the room.
"I lost my job," Hayley said bluntly. "Judy is closing the business at the end of June."
"Ouch, sorry."
Gingerly, Hayley sat on the edge of Amy's bed, half afraid of what might be lurking under the covers.
"It's the story of my life," she said. "One step forward, two steps back. It gets boring after a while, you know?"
"Don't be depressed," Amy said heartily. "I have a way we both can make a ton of money this summer."
"What? And don't say we'll buy lottery tickets. You know I'm against gambling."
"Nothing like that,"
Amy assured her, plopping down next to Hayley.
"This girl I know from my psych class told me she's been working as a summer nanny on Nantucket for the past 2 years. She says it's a great way to earn money without having to be cooped up in an office, staring at a computer, or standing on your feet waiting tables all day."
Hayley frowned. It was bad enough cleaning the houses of the well-to-do, but to be compelled to cater to the whims of their spoiled brats?
"No, thanks," she said.
"What do you mean?" Amy asked. "You're great with kids. Look, my friend told me how to go about finding a job as a nanny. It's super easy."
"The idea is absurd," Hayley said. "Rich people seeking a caretaker for their children would never hire someone like me, with my casually criminal family and lack of education."
"Don't be silly. I don't even have babysitting references like you do," Amy pointed out.
"But that's not stopping me. Look, my friend got to go with one of her families to Aruba for 2 weeks. She said it was fantastic. We could get a free vacation."
"Nothing is ever really free, Amy," Hayley pointed out. "Your friend paid for that holiday in hard labor, you can be sure. She wasn't the one lazing on a beach chair sipping pina coladas or whatever it is people drink in Aruba."
Amy sighed.
"Why do you always have to be so negative?"
"Practical," Hayley corrected. "And if it comes across to some people as negative, I can't help that."
Amy looked genuinely crestfallen, and Hayley felt a surge of guilt for having quashed her friend's enthusiasm.
"All right," she said. "I promise to think about it, but don't hold your breath."
"Why would I do that?" Amy asked.
Hayley rolled her eyes heavenward.
"Never mind."
Chapter 6. Lita was taking a brief respite from her work,
but only a brief one, because one of her longtime clients was anxious for the delivery of the embroidered placemats and matching napkins she had ordered. Carolyn's college nemesis was coming for luncheon at the end of the week, and she was eager to impress. Lita thought the idea of impressing someone you hadn't seen for over 40 years was slightly ridiculous, but she had held her tongue. Now, resting on the love seat in her studio, Lita found herself gazing at her formal wedding portrait. She kept it on a shelf over her work table. Lita and Charlie had married only months after meeting in the lobby of a small movie theater in South Berwick. They had taken to each other right away. The 18-year-old Lita had been desperately seeking a refuge after the awful thing that had happened to her the previous summer, and marriage to Charlie had provided that refuge, if only for a short while. Lita's cell rang. It was Phil Morse from Wainscoting and Window Seats.
"I just sold the last of your eyeglass cases and tissue holders," Phil told her. "You wouldn't by chance have any more at hand."
"No," Lita told him, "but I can easily make up at least 5 of each in the next few days, just as soon as I finish a custom order for Carolyn Cheswick."
"Great, and I'll probably sell those quickly too,"
Lita smiled. "Impulse purchases.
And they're perfect as little gifts to the self for the customer who's in need of retail therapy," Phil pointed out. "Do you want me to pick them up when you're done?"
"I'll drop them off," Lita told him.
"Thanks, Lita," Phil said.
After the call ended, Lita finished her cup of tea and went to her desk to record Phil's order and to schedule the work into her weekly planner. When you ran your own one-person business, organization was key. Lita was pleased that her accessory items continued to sell briskly. It cost her very little to make eyeglass cases, tissue holders, and even coin purses. She used scraps of material left over from larger projects, and she always kept a good stock of buttons and zippers and snaps on hand. Accessory items brought a tidy profit for very little work and expenditure. Lita rose from her desk and went over to her work table to resume work on Carolyn's order. Amy had told her that Hayley had lost her job with the cleaning company. Hayley would land on her feet, of that Lita felt sure, but she so wished that something magical would happen for her, if not in the shape of a knight in shining armor, because that scenario hardly ever worked out, then in the shape of a solid opportunity for advancement. It saddened Lita to see a bright young woman so burdened with her family's woes. Thankfully, family woes were something with which Amy had never had to contend. True, the death of her beloved grandparents had hit her hard, but both had been in ill health for some time, so their passing wasn't entirely unexpected. Even at the age of 7, Amy had been sensitive enough to realize that Grandma and Grandpa hadn't been enjoying much quality of life, and that in some ways, their deaths were a blessing to them.
"It's me."
The unexpected whisper almost made Lita jump out of her skin.
"I didn't hear you come in,"
Lita said to Vera, her hand to her heart. "The door didn't slam."
"Shh,"
Vera hissed.
"I think I'm being followed."
Vera tiptoed toward one of the windows that looked over the side yard.
"I think I saw someone watching my house this morning," she said. "And when I went to the post office, there was a strange man staring at me from across the street."
Lita shook her head and wondered if her eminently sane friend was finally losing her mind. "Who could possibly be watching you?" she asked. Gingerly, Vera pushed aside the sheer curtain less than half an inch and peered out.
"The police,"
she said.
"Or one of Kitty's old criminal cronies."
Lita got up from the work table and took her friend's arm.
"Come away from there," she said. "What you need is a nice cup of tea to calm your nerves."
Vera looked at her with wide eyes.
"Haven't you got any whiskey?" she asked.
Chapter 7. Hayley was only a few blocks from home, rather from the apartment in which the Franklins were currently residing. No place had felt like home for years. Homes were places in which you could let down your guard and feel secure. No one could feel secure with Eddie Franklin on site. And the truth was that the current situation in which she and her mother found themselves was the fault of one long ago, very bad romantic mistake on the part of Nora Mackenzie, a naive and innocent young woman who had been taken in by a handsome face and a quicksilver tongue. As for Hayley, she was not looking for or expecting love, and caring led to grave mistakes. The last thing she wanted was to get trapped in a ridiculously bad marriage like her mother had. When you let your emotions get involved, even the smartest person got stupid, and fast. Hayley had no intention of getting stupid, which is the main reason she had never had a boyfriend. She wasn't a virgin, but what sex she had engaged in had been on her own terms and had most definitely not involved the heart. When Hayley reached 16 Rockford Way, she parked in the small lot behind the building, next to her neighbor's beat-up vehicles. Warily, she walked around to the front of the building, pushed open the door, and stepped into the small, dark foyer. She could hear the old woman in the tiny first-floor apartment warbling along to a radio set to a country music station. Heavy footsteps overhead told her that one of the two young guys who rented an apartment on the second floor was home. Hayley went over to the narrow wooden table against the wall on which the mail carrier deposited the tenant's letters, bills, and coupon flyers. She sorted through the mess and extricated anything addressed to the Franklins. Two bills, a catalog addressed to Edward Franklin or current resident, and a letter-size envelope addressed to Nora Franklin. Hayley frowned. She recognized the handwriting on the envelope, large and awkward. It belonged to her brother. It was odd that he would write a letter rather than call, and for a moment, Hayley wondered if Brandon was seriously ill or in terrible trouble with the law. She might not feel affection for her brother, but she didn't wish him harm. If he was sick or in trouble, then it might be better for her to read his letter before passing it on to her mother. Hayley could foresee a scene of panic if her mother received bad news about her son without first being prepared. With a glance at the steep stairs covered with a dirty carpet, Hayley opened the envelope. Inside, she found a single sheet of lined paper torn from a small notebook. "Mom," it said, "it's me, Brandon. How are you?" "I'm fine, but I need money bad. Send me what you got. Like $500 would be good. Brandon." Hayley frowned and shoved the letter back into the envelope. She should have known. Her bum of a brother, currently living in Augusta, needed money. More likely he wanted money, probably for booze or some stupid purchase he would only wind up breaking or losing. No doubt about it, she had done the right thing by opening the letter. If her mother had seen it, she would immediately have sent off whatever money she had in her purse, whether the family could spare it or not. Her hands trembling with anger, Hayley tore the envelope and letter in half, and in half again. Then she left the building, went around back to where the garbage cans shared by the building's tenants were located, and buried the pieces of paper in an open plastic bag, poking out of one of the cans. Her hands felt filthy, and not only because of the brown banana peel, damp towels, and other refuse she had accidentally touched while making her brother's selfish request go away. Hayley went back into the building and began the climb to the third floor. Her mind was made up. Things had to change. She would take Amy's advice and apply for a position as a summer nanny. With any luck, she would get a position that paid really well, and she would hold on to the money. And one day, one wonderful day, Hayley and her mother would walk away from Yorktide and all the sad memories it held for them. And they would never look back. Chapter 8.
"Guess what?" Amy said, taking a carton of milk from the fridge. "I'm applying for a job as a nanny this summer."
Her mother frowned. "Are you sure that's a good idea?" she asked.
"Why wouldn't it be? I could make a lot of money if I'm lucky."
"I saw Noah Woolrich in town earlier," her mother said brightly.
"That's nice,"
Amy said, joining her mother at the table and adding some milk to her cup of tea. She knew why her mother had changed the subject. Lita Latimer harbored a desire for her daughter to fall in love with Noah Woolrich. He was super nice and smart and good-looking, but for some reason Amy herself didn't understand. She wasn't able to return his feelings. "He looks good," her mother went on. "He looks so robust and healthy. Amy sighed.
Mom, please. So, is Vera in the clear with the police? I mean, they don't think she was Kitty's accomplice, do they?
No, she's not a suspect. But she did think she was being watched by either the police or one of Kitty's criminal buddies.
Amy shook her head. It would be funny if it weren't so sad.
I've got to run this box over to Phil's shop, her mother said, reaching for her bag. I'll be back soon and we can talk more about that nanny position.
Amy laughed. There's nothing to talk about.
When her mother had gone, Amy wandered into the living room with her cup of tea. On the credenza, there was a portrait of her grandparents taken on their wedding day way back in 1974. Her grandfather had been like a father to Amy. He had definitely been the man of the house, the one who fixed the food disposal when a chicken bone got caught in it, the one who mowed the lawn, the one who kept an eye on the boiler in the basement. Amy couldn't remember one time they had had to call in a professional fix-it guy. And her grandmother had been like a second mother. When Amy's mom was at work at the real estate agency, Grandma had been the one to remind Amy to put her dirty clothes into the laundry hamper, the one to make Amy's lunches to take to school, even the one to review Amy's homework. It had been an idyllic upbringing in a lot of ways, and Amy was grateful for what she had enjoyed, never more so than when she listened to Hayley talk about her own troubled home life. Poor Hayley. Amy hoped she would seriously consider the idea of working as a nanny. They could have so much fun hanging out together with all the kids. In fact, it might just be like summer camp. Amy had never gone to summer camp, but she knew that the counselors and the kids had a great time together, doing crafts and going swimming and making s'mores over a roaring fire. And on the 4th of July, they might have a bonfire and set off fireworks. Or, if that was too dangerous, at least they could all wave around sparklers. How different was a nanny from a camp counselor? Probably not all that different. It was probably oodles and oodles of fun. Amy finished her tea and went to the kitchen to put her cup in the sink. She had a very strong feeling that this summer was going to be the absolute best summer of her life.
Chapter 9.
Lita sat at one of the two looms in her bright and airy studio. The cats were sprawled at her feet, relaxing after a brutally challenging morning of eating and chasing each other up and down the stairs. The house was quiet. Amy had gone off to class just after breakfast. It was the perfect atmosphere in which to work on the latest project for one of her longtime clients, but Lita's mind simply would not focus on her craft. Instead, it insisted on returning to a pivotal moment in the long, distant past. Lita knew her fears were irrational. There was no logical reason why Amy's working as a nanny this summer should carry with it any greater risk of danger than her working as a waitress or a checkout person. When you thought about it, walking dogs was probably far riskier than looking after someone else's children in the security of their own home. Dogs could turn on you and bite. Lita frowned, just like people. The thing was, Lita was scared that the past was poised to repeat itself. She had never told this to Amy, but at the age of 17, she had taken a job as a summer nanny for a family from upstate New York. Lance Sterling was a fairly well-known painter, and his wife, Regan, looked after the home and their one-year-old daughter, Rebecca. That summer, Regan had explained, the family needed to hire a nanny so that Regan could spend her time pursuing an online degree in Egyptology. The Sterlings treated Lita politely, and Rebecca was an easygoing child. The money was adequate, and Regan even provided a homemade meal each day. Everything seemed just fine, if, in fact, a little boring. But it didn't remain boring for long. Looking at the loom before her, Lita saw not strands of cotton of varying color, width, and texture, but her teenage self, intensely drawn to the man who was her employer. In her infatuation, she had thought that Lance's artfully wild hair made him look like one of the romantic poets, or, better yet, a rock star. His hand-rolled cigarettes had made him seem exotically European. His black moods had made him seem deep and soulful. His eyes, a penetrating green, had seemed to divine her most secret thoughts. Lita had done her best to hide her attraction, but when she noticed that Lance was spending a fair amount of time following her with those penetrating eyes, she allowed her own gaze to linger. Abruptly, Lita got up from the loom and crossed to the window that faced the small backyard with its stone birdbath, its ancient lilac bush, its recently mowed grass. Sadly, the lovely scene had no power to quiet her troubled emotions. Even after all these years, the memories of what happened that summer still had the power to anger and embarrass her. But once the memories had come to the forefront of her mind, Lita had no choice but to let them play out. Staring unseeingly at a small yellow bird perched on the edge of the birdbath, she remembered how it wasn't long before Lance Sterling began to request her company in his studio while his daughter napped and his wife studied at her computer. He told Lita that her presence soothed him. He told her that because she was an artist with an artist's soul, she understood him in ways his wife could not. When Lita protested that her fiber work was simply a hobby, he scolded her for her lack of self-worth and told her that she was wonderful, special, beautiful. He made sketches for her and signed them with a flourish. He picked wildflowers and wove them through her hair. He wrote her poems. He told her that he loved her, that she was his muse, that they were fated to be together. He began to speak in husky whispers when they met, to touch her arm surreptitiously when they passed in the hall, to kiss her urgently behind the half-closed door of his studio. He told her that he loved her. One of the cats rumbled in his sleep, and Lita jumped. Once again, she had slid so deeply into her foolish youth. Lita put her hands to her temples as she remembered what had come next. She had felt guilty about what was now undoubtedly an affair. But at the same time, she had also felt elated, powerful, and sure. How could being in love ever be wrong? The world would forgive any transgression made in the name of love. It had to forgive. And so, one day, when Lance's wife was away visiting a friend, Lita had gone to bed with him. Lita turned away from the window and its view of her serene backyard and wandered over to the comfy love seat. She sank onto it and pulled an embroidered pillow onto her lap. What had happened then was the very worst part of the whole mess. The day after she had been with Lance, she had gone to the Sterling home, literally tingling with excitement, anticipating more protestations of love and passionate embraces behind half-closed doors. But instead of greeting Lita with his provocative smile, Lance had told her that he was too busy to waste time chatting with the nanny and had retreated to his studio, closing the door behind him. Lita was devastated by this sudden coldness, which only grew icier by the day. One afternoon, less than a week after Lita had lost her virginity to Lance Sterling, she confronted him, begging to know what she had done to cause him to reject her. "It's run its course," Lance had told her harshly, stabbing at a canvas with his brush, hand-rolled cigarette dangling from the corner of his mouth. "Let it go."
"I can't let it go,"
Lita remembered, crying out.
"I won't."
Lance had turned from his canvas. Even from the depths of her misery, Lita had been able to recognize the look of disgust on his face.
"That's enough," he snapped. "Get a hold of yourself."
But Lita could not get a hold of herself. She threatened to tell his wife what had happened between them.
"Go ahead,"
Lance said with a laugh, turning back to his work.
"It won't make any difference."
Lita had run from the studio then, fighting nausea. She knew she didn't really have the nerve to approach Regan Sterling with the truth. She had no idea how she would finish out the summer working in such close quarters with Lance and his wife. Before she could give the immediate future any further thought, Regan and little Rebecca returned from their daily walk.
"I need to talk to you,"
Regan said to Lita. Lita had gone numb with fear. She had no idea what to expect from Lance's wronged wife.
"Look," Regan had gone on.
If not exactly sympathetic, her tone betrayed no anger.
"You're not the first kid Lance has seduced, and you won't be the last. He's an artist.
He has no time for the restricting social conventions of the middle class. The fact is, you mean nothing to him, just as all the others in the past meant nothing to him, and just as all the ones to come will mean nothing. It's me he loves, and me he'll never leave. Me and Rebecca. His family. It was then that Lita heard a noise in the hall behind her, and turning, caught sight of Lance, paintbrush stuck behind his ear, the ubiquitous cigarette in hand. He glanced at her as he passed, shrugged, and continued on. It was at that moment that Lita Latimer finally understood that she had been merely a notch on Lance Sterling's bedpost. Lita ran from the house and never went back. She didn't call to tender her resignation. She didn't write a note demanding what salary she was owed. She put her head down and waited for repercussions, but none came. Lance and Regan Sterling left Yorktide at the end of the summer, and she never saw or heard from them again. The weeks immediately after the debacle had been the worst in Lita's life. She told her parents that she had been let go because the Sterlings had changed their mind about needing a nanny. If her mother or father suspected the truth or something like it, they chose not to question her. And for that, Lita was thankful. She could never have admitted to her parents that she had been so foolish as to fall for a married man, or so cruel as to interfere in someone else's marriage. But even if she had been able to confess, what good would telling them have accomplished? The deed could not be undone. Full of self-loathing, Lita abandoned her plans to attend Yorktide Community College that fall and took a menial job in a small local factory. Before the end of the year, she had begun to date a nice local boy named Charlie Latimer. They married the following spring, and she still thought of Lance Sterling with longing. She knew that something was deeply wrong with her for not being able to let go of feelings for a man who had treated her so badly, but she just couldn't seem to help herself. The longing was stronger than the anger. By summer, Lita was pregnant. Amy was born when Lita was 19 years old. And before Amy had celebrated her first birthday, Charlie was gone. He broke his neck in a fall from scaffolding while working a construction site. Lita mourned his death, but not for very long. She hadn't really known the man she had married. The one and only good thing that resulted from Charlie's sudden death was that it served to completely kill all feelings for Lance Sterling that still lingered disturbingly in Lita's heart. Charlie's untimely end had catapulted Lita into adulthood. Lita rose from the love seat and went to her loom, determined to return to the responsibilities of the present. Of course, the past wasn't necessarily doomed to repeat itself. That was superstitious thinking. Still, it was hard to shake off the feeling of deep anxiety that had burrowed its way into her chest since Amy had announced her intention of taking a position as a nanny this summer. At 21, Amy was even more naive than Lita had been at 17. It was entirely likely that Amy might fall prey to an unscrupulous employee as had her mother. But there was nothing Lita could do to stop her daughter from pursuing the path she had chosen. She was, after all, an adult. Lita could only hope that whoever hired Amy was not a predator like Lance Sterling had been. That wasn't too much to hope for, was it? Chapter 10. Hayley was on her way to the Goodwill shop in Wells. She had considered asking Amy to come along, but had then thought better of it. Amy's enthusiasm for shopping could wear on Haley's nerves. She had never seen anyone get so excited by such trivial things as sequins on socks and blouses with cutout shoulders. She was on her way to Goodwill because, through the employment agency Amy's friend had suggested, Hayley had almost immediately been offered interviews with three families. Interviews meant clothing that wasn't worn through in spots and faded in others. The first interview was with a John and Marissa Whitby. They were already renting a house in Ogunquit, though they didn't require the services of a nanny until mid-June. They had two-year-old twin girls, Lily and Layla. John Whitby was the founder and CEO of Whitby Wealth Management, a firm based in Greenwich, Connecticut. Marissa Whitby, currently a full-time mother, had worked as a translator for a Paris-based publishing house before the birth of her children. On paper,
they were a formidable couple. Who knew how disconcerting they would be in person? Hayley hadn't told her mother that her job at Squeaky Clean would be ending shortly. Nora had enough to deal with without worrying about her daughter's lost income. When Hayley landed another job, she would break the news. And if she was lucky, that might be soon. Once inside the store, Hayley resisted the temptation of the book section. She was here to buy clothes suitable for work. For a moment, facing what seemed like acres of options, she regretted not having asked Amy to come along. She had always been in awe of how Amy knew how to accessorize. It was a creative flair she had probably inherited from her mother. She could take any old t-shirt and jeans and transform the two basic pieces into an outfit by tossing on a long scarf and wearing high-heeled sandals instead of sneakers. But Hayley hadn't invited Amy, and so here she was, on her own. She began to flip through the racks of clothing. She figured that a nanny needed clothes that were practical and befitted her position in the household of a wealthy family. It was almost 40 minutes before she had selected what she thought might be appropriate items and brought them to the dressing room. She tried on the taupe A-line dress first. The neutral color seemed a smart choice. And, as Hayley looked at herself in the full-length mirror, she felt a very alien spark of specialness. She looked good. Very good. And then she frowned. These new clothes were not to make her look pretty. They were in service of a specific goal. And if she didn't achieve that goal, the clothes would go to a resale shop and she would hope to make back a portion of the money she had spent. Still, Hayley wondered what her father would say when he saw her in the new clothes, assuming, of course, he would even bother to notice. If he did notice, no doubt he would rant about her spending his hard-earned money, which was, of course, ridiculous. She was spending her own hard-earned money. But her father's feelings were beside the point. What had to matter most was that she was taking what might turn out to be a big step toward improving her life and her mother's life as well. In the end, Hayley bought the taupe dress, a pair of chinos, 3 t-shirts, and a lightweight cotton jacket for a grand total of $60. If that wasn't smart shopping, Hayley didn't know what was. Chapter 11. Amy yawned, this time so widely she heard her jaw crack. Something in her head, anyway. The semester was nearing its end. Exams and final papers were killing her, but she thought she was doing okay. If only she could stop yawning and pay attention to her work and not focus so much on the summer ahead. But that was seriously difficult. The thing was, Amy and Hayley had signed on with a reputable employment agency that specialized in placing nannies with appropriate families. So far, Amy hadn't gotten even one interview, and always for the same reason: a lack of experience. Amy knew she was a good person. If only someone would give her a chance to prove herself. Amy returned to the employment agency's homepage and read for what seemed like the millionth time the official description of the job. A nanny is responsible for following a parent's instructions regarding the care of his/her child. A nanny is responsible for meeting the child/children's needs, be they emotional, physical, intellectual, or social. A nanny. Maybe applying for a job as a nanny had been a silly idea in the first place, Amy thought dejectedly. Hayley was faring way better. She already had 3 families interested in her. Well, that was to be expected. She was so smart and had so much more work experience. Amy exited the site and checked her email account. She didn't use it much and sometimes forgot to look at it for weeks on end. But now, she was very glad that she had, because there in her inbox was an offer of an interview from a family seeking a nanny for the summer. The email had come from someone named Cressida Pryor. The name sounded vaguely familiar, but Amy didn't waste time trying to figure out where she might have heard it. She read the brief email several times with interest. Cressida Pryor had found Amy's name and contact information via the employment agency and, in the interest of preserving her valuable time, had decided to contact Amy directly. Ms. Pryor was seeking a nanny to look after her 2 children, a boy age 8 and a girl age 10. Amy felt her spirits rise. She wouldn't have to change diapers or give the children baths, and she would definitely have fun taking them to the beach and building sandcastles and going for ice cream after. Children that age were cool. There was no mention of a father or of any household staff. There was no mention of the children's names. Cressida Pryor told her to be at the Atlantic promptly at 12:15 on Thursday. It struck Amy as a bit odd that Ms. Pryor assumed she would want to apply for the job, but the fact was that she did want to apply. She would have to reschedule an appointment she had made for a pedicure, but that was no problem. The Atlantic? It was a seriously high-end restaurant. There was no way Amy and her mother could afford to eat there. Well, maybe they could share an appetizer without breaking the bank, but that was about all. Now the question was, what should she wear to an interview in such a fancy setting? Amy ran to her closet and began the search. Homework could wait. Chapter 12. "Coffee's ready," Lita announced. She brought the French press to the table, where Amy was devouring a cinnamon Danish. Lita was only sorry that Amy hadn't thought to buy a Danish for her mother as well. "Thanks, Mom," Amy said when Lita placed the pot on the table and took a seat across from her daughter. Lita took a sip of the hot coffee. After having been turned down by 3 prospective employers, Amy had finally been granted an interview with a family in search of a summer nanny. Lita did not feel great about this. "Are you absolutely sure you want to work as a nanny this summer?" Lita said with a poor attempt at sounding casual. "There are plenty of other jobs around town. Maybe Vera could hire you. You know waitstaff are always coming and going." "Mom," Amy wailed, wiping her hands on her napkin. "We've been over this like a million times. I want to be a nanny, and I told you I have an interview."
"You could get a job at the Starfish," Lita said, somewhat desperately. "I hear they pay well."
Amy smiled. "Doing what, being a chambermaid? I have enough trouble making my own bed. Who came up with the idea of fitted sheets? Do you know how many nails I've broken trying to make my bed?"
"I could see if Phil needs help at wainscoting and window seats," Lita offered.
Amy rolled her eyes. "I don't understand why you're so down on the idea of my being a nanny," she said. "It's a great way to make money, and there can be all sorts of perks. I read that sometimes employers give their nannies use of their own cars to run errands. I might even get to drive a car made after 2010.
Lita sighed. "Are you sure you won't just consider asking Vera for a job at Overeasy?"
"Totally sure," Amy said firmly. "I'd much rather spend my days watching over a child in someone's fancy house than waiting tables. You're on your feet for hours at a time, and you have to deal with some really fussy customers, people who send their pancakes back because they don't look like the pancakes their mother made."
"Caring for someone else's children is also hard work," Lita pointed out, "and you might get saddled with really fussy parents who make doing your job nigh impossible."
Amy shrugged. "I'll deal with all that. You know I'm pretty easygoing."
"It can be a difficult thing," Lita said carefully. "Being thrust into a family with its own dynamics so different from your own."
"Yeah, but I'm not applying to be a live-in nanny. I'll be home every night."
Amy reached across the table and squeezed Lita's hand.
"Don't worry, Mom. I'll still have my own life."
"Be as careful choosing the family as they'll be choosing you. It needs to be a good fit for both parties."
I know. I'm not stupid."
"I didn't say that you were," Lita protested. "What's the name of this family with whom you're interviewing?"
"Cressida Pryor is the mother. I don't know yet if there's a father around."
"Something about that name sounds familiar," Lita noted.
"I know," Amy said. "I thought so too."
"I wonder why she's asked to interview you at a restaurant. Why not interview you at her hotel?"
"Mom, what does it matter where we meet?"
Lita smiled. "You're right, it doesn't matter." What mattered, she thought, was that her daughter was hired by decent, respectable people. And for that, she could only pray. Chapter 13. Hayley reached into the top drawer for a can opener. Her mother loved baked beans, so once a week she made a meal around them. Tonight, she would serve the beans with a salad and a pan of cornbread she had made from a convenient mix. And even though Hayley didn't care whether her father ate dinner or not, she always made sure to prepare enough for 3.
It was for her mother's sake that she did this. Her mother cared whether Eddie Franklin had a hearty meal at the end of the day. As she prepared the meal, Hayley considered her experience earlier at the Whitby home. She had approached the interview with an uneasy mix of hope and resentment, and ready to find Marissa Whitby a smug, self-satisfied woman who would view Hayley through the lens of privilege and find her sadly lacking. All through the time they had spent together, both alone and with the children, Hayley had been waiting for the revelation of high-handed snobbery, but it had never come. Hayley remembered getting out of her car. She had worn the taupe dress she had bought at Goodwill, and looking up in awe at the house the Whitby family was renting. It was very large. Its shingles were mellowed with age to a soft silvery gray. There was an old-fashioned wraparound porch on which were grouped white wicker chairs and wooden rocking chairs. Four large pots of flowers were placed at intervals along the portion of the porch facing the road. Hayley counted three chimneys. She had lifted the brass knocker in the shape of an anchor and knocked twice. Marissa Whitby had opened the door a moment later, wearing a pair of cargo pants rolled at the ankle and a loose button-down shirt. In one hand, she held a dish towel, and in the other, a spatula. "Come in," she said with a smile. "I had a hankering for pancakes," she explained as she ushered Hayley into the house. "Would you like some?" Hayley had declined the offer, but had accepted a cup of coffee. The interview had been held at the kitchen table, where Marissa had scarfed down four pancakes in an impressive few minutes. Hayley had appreciated her straightforward way of asking questions and her attentive way of listening to the answers. Marissa had explained that she had agreed to teach a course that summer at Yorktide Community College, which was the reason she needed to hire a nanny. "It's a favor," she explained. The director of the Romance Language...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.